Hello, ladies and gentlemen, and a warm welcome to today's webinar, which is brought to you by Consider Solutions and Shared Services Link. Today, we're looking at leading indicators. What's so key about your KPIs? So my name is Susie West, and I am the CEO and founder at Shared Services Link. And I'm delighted that our guest speaker today is Dan French, who is the CEO at Consider Solutions. You, of course, do have a role to play, which is to really rack your brains and think about the questions that you're seeking answers to. Please get those to me as soon as you can, and I will be putting those questions to Dan in the last 10 minutes of this webinar. So let's have a look at the context for this webinar. I think we're all very familiar with the notion of a KPI. They absolutely help drive the right behaviour in the organisation, or at least that is the intention of a KPI if they are used correctly. And they also help tell a story, and they can be very illustrative of where perhaps there is a problem potentially if they are used again correctly. And these are two areas that we're really going to be delving into over the next 10 minutes. And because of the potential that is here, it does mean a lot of thoughtfulness is required when architecting your KPI framework, which will really help serve your business's goals and strategic direction, and really making sure that everybody in the organization is KPI'd in a way that helps you get to your goals a little bit quicker and more elegantly. This session really will be looking at how to get the most out of your KPIs, and we'll be zeroing in quite a bit on leading indicators and really looking at how they might serve you differently to lagging indicators, which a lot of people in finance and procurement tend to be drawing on. With all that in mind, I would like to introduce Dan French from Consider. Over to you, please, Dan.
Thanks, Susie. Good afternoon, everybody, or good morning or good evening, depending where you are in the world right now. What's so key about your KPIs? Susie's going to introduce the topic. And the subtext of this is, are your performance measures really fit for purpose? It's joined by a number of people who are attending this event. It's a challenge for us all, and it doesn't seem to go away. So hopefully shed a bit of light on that. My name's Dan French, as Susie's already said. My company focuses on the theme of world-class finance, and particularly process optimization, risk management, and control and compliance. Now, this discussion on KPIs is not limited, clearly, to finance shared services. So if you happen to be a HR shared services person on this call, don't feel left out. The whole theme and thinking behind this is relevant to anyone. It's just our subject matter domain expertise is mostly around finance and accounting. It's a complex problem, a complex set of problems, and somebody who had a great way with tautology, Donald Rumsfeld, had a great way of saying this. What he's really trying to say is there's some complex problems and maybe some opportunities. We have some of the answers, but we never know all of the questions. But he gave his great known knowns, known unknowns, and unknown unknowns, and then confused himself completely. But I think you get the gist. What we are going to share, what we've observed, what we've learned, and what we've seen working, but there's always more to learn. So in terms of themes and perspectives as an agenda, this is the way I'm going to talk through the topic, talk about KPIs and shared services, talk about the trouble and the challenges of traditional KPIs, enter into a discussion about leading and lagging indicators, how do we use indicators to drive behavior, and engaging with the customer and communicating progress, and then some recommendations and summary, and give you time for questions at the end. We're also going to make you work a little during this. We have some questions for you as we go through, and a number of polls. So I think we have one to start off with, Susie.
Thank you very much. What is your biggest challenge in driving performance with KPIs in your organization? Is it that you have too many KPIs? Is it that you have a little bit of a challenge choosing the right KPIs? Is it the measuring of the KPIs? Is it communicating performance progress, or is it identifying what actions are needed to improve performance? So if you can just tick one of these, please. We're looking for your biggest challenge. We do like to get the response rates up to 70%. And I should also note for you, we will be documenting the responses to the 6 poll questions that we've got over the next 60 minutes and illustrating the responses in a very nice report, which we will be sharing with you. So let's try and get these responses up to the high 70s, if not 80s. Closing the poll in 3, 2, 1. Okay, we're at 79% there. So as we always do, we will be sharing these results immediately. So they are very much live benchmarking events. So coming up on your screen now. And you can see there is an out-and-out winner as far as the biggest challenge in driving performance with KPIs in your organization is concerned. The main problem is 57% of you said it was choosing the right KPIs. Back to you, please, Dan.
Right, that's an interesting insight, and that aligns with general experience. Okay, thank you all for that. Okay, so let's talk a little bit about KPIs and shared services. We know what a key performance indicator is meant to be. We know it's a measure to help us with reporting, comparing, and motivating performance improvement. So that sounds great. That's what it's meant to do. And judging from that poll result about getting the right KPIs, obviously the ones we choose don't always do all those things. So let's think about this issue of KPIs in the context of the finance journey. So you're all probably very well aware of these metrics on the road to world-class finance. It was generally accepted that leaders who are producing best-in-class, world-class finance functions are running those finance functions at approaching 0.5% of revenue of the company, through to laggards who are close to 2%. So there's a massive drive. 1%, 1.5% on a large company's revenue is a big number that goes to the bottom line. So there's a massive drive here to drive efficiency and effectiveness. And as you see in this schematic, shared services is a key part of that. It's a key part of driving efficiency and effectiveness. And we need continuous improvement because this isn't the end of the journey. We've got to keep going. So ways of measuring and comparing and improving ourselves is absolutely critical. So that's the context of why we're using KPIs in shared services and indeed across the rest of the business. Let's think about some of the classic KPIs. You'll have many of these, and I'm sure more. But if you look at, let's say, the purchase-to-pay cycle, you've got purchase-to-pay and accounts payable, a classic set of KPIs here, those that deal with efficiency, like invoice process per FTE, those deal with real cash savings, like discounts captured. And these are the kind of things that many organizations are measuring today. If you look on the revenue cycle, again, you've got a similar picture, efficiency-based indicators, and those that drive real cash in the organization, like DSO. And then in record to report, again, pretty classic stuff where the key business outcome is really closing time. So whether you're targeting a 4-working day or 5-working day close, and then the other ones are about efficiency and getting there. So all those KPIs look fine. So what's the issue? Despite this enormous use of KPIs in pretty much every organization, what are these challenges that make it so difficult to choose the right ones and make them work for us? Now we have another poll here, I think, Susie.
We certainly do. Thank you, Dan. Second poll of the day. How good are the KPIs in your organization for what they are intended to achieve? Are they perfect? Are they good? Are they mediocre? Are they bad? Or are they awful?
And it is anonymous, of course, so you can say what you want.
Closing the poll in 3, 2, 1. We were at 76% of you responding. Let's have a look at the results coming up on your screen. Now, interestingly, no one on the call believes that they are perfect. No one on the call believes that they are awful. And the majority of people, 96% of you, believe they are either good or mediocre. Back to you, please, Dan.
Okay, that's another interesting insight there. There's a couple of critical issues with KPIs. And the first one is they're like looking in the rearview mirror, looking back at activities that happened and outcomes. You know, it's good to look backwards. We learn things from looking backwards, but you've got to be very careful with this as the only perspective. And the other key thing with that rearview mirror is KPIs are typically tied to performance measures for individuals and incentives and ultimately one's progression, bonuses, and all the rest of it. And the challenge here is that when we do focus and incent people on achieving certain things, things do change, but they're not always what we expect. And I think one of the challenges here is whether KPIs are actually driving intelligent action or driving sometimes mindless action. So I've got this big belief in the law of unintended consequences, and KPIs are right in the center of this particular storm. So here's a number of KPI examples, which are genuine examples from out there. In fact, one's just come up in the past couple of weeks. You know, KPIs look perfectly reasonable, like in call centers, so people measure, they have targets on number of calls handled per day, per operator. That seems perfectly reasonable. Although the problem is, to achieve that KPI, you'll find lots of people experiencing that those calls are deliberately cut short, even if the customer issue isn't resolved, because they want to get through the number of calls and not actually satisfy the customer. So therefore, you've got an unintended consequence, which isn't really helping the overall business situation. Revenue per customer is another example, which I've seen in a frightening way, where the organization wanted to maximize revenue per customer, but it's a simple ratio, and the easiest way of fixing that is to get rid of some customers, and not always what you want. So you can get rid of small customers, which will increase your ratio quite well. But these small customers may be tomorrow's big customers. It might be the worst thing to do for the business. So we've got to be very, very careful what questions we're asking and what performance measures we're putting in place. The vendor payment performance, that's going to come up a little bit in one of the examples shortly, but you know, is it really in our interest to pay vendors as fast as possible unless we're getting something for it, like early payment discounts? So it's in itself, is it a good performance indicator? That one at the bottom, U.S. Investigation Services, was quite frightening. In the Wall Street Journal 2 weeks ago, a big article about this organization, which is a company that does clearance processing for the U.S. federal government. And in the wake of the Edward Snowden affair, there's been lots of complaints about the number of clearances that didn't seem to work out so well. And what it transpires is, you know, for the past 2 or 3 years, there's been very clear focus on performance measures on hitting a certain number of thousands processing applications every day. Now, if that's the key performance indicator for the business, you can tell exactly where that's going to go. So the law of unintended consequences is alive and well, and we've got to be very, very careful. When we choose a KPI, we've got to think very carefully what's going to happen when we focus people on achieving it. So let's look at a couple of KPI benchmarks. I like this one. It's purchase to pay cycle, and this is of general interest anyway. These are benchmarks from various good companies who've done this work. It's useful information, but the key question I keep asking myself is, do they all make sense in the wider context? I just talked a little bit about payment on time. So according to these assessments, best-in-class companies pay 20% faster than laggards. Now, since that's cash out of the door, again, if that in return for a discount that makes sense, that's fine. But just paying fast, short of an agreed payment terms, isn't necessarily very sensible. And the number one here, the invoice cycle time from receipt to approval. Well, is invoice cycle time, the elapsed time, a really important measure for us for the purchase-to-pay cycle? It might be for the revenue cycle, but this cycle time might not be the key issue. What we really want to know is, are we doing it within an appropriate time but at lowest cost? That might be the answer. So when you look at all these benchmarks, it's good to have benchmarks, but we also want to think, are those benchmarks I actually want to aim for, or are there other things that are more important? So it's just worth thinking about that. So the danger with KPIs is that if the KPI culture gets pushed too hard without appropriate balance, you get this kind of twin-track society where the KPIs are looking great, but it's covering up a nasty old situation under the covers. And I think we've all seen situations where we've seen a full set of green traffic lights on a particular business process and known that there's something fundamentally wrong, but everyone's happy that we've managed to meet the KPIs. So it's very, very important for us to make sure, are we doing this to present ourselves in the sunniest way, or are we doing this to really identify improvement opportunities and be as good as we can? Susie, I think we've got another poll here.
Thank you, Dan. So what is the strongest characteristic of your current KPIs? Or indeed, what are the two strongest characteristics? Are they quantifiable and comparable? Are they timely, accessible, actionable, or none of the above? Please select the two that reflect the strongest characteristics of your current KPI set. Closing the poll in 3, 2, 1. We were at 75% of you responding, and you can see that the majority of people believe that they are quantifiable and comparable, and at the lower end we have actionable. Interesting results, back to you, Dan.
I think that's I think that's very interesting, and that relates to much of the theme of this talk. Whether our measures give us actions we can make improvements on is a critical question and a critical criteria we need to set ourselves. So we know there's issues with KPIs. We know that the law of unintended consequences is alive and well. And various people have tried to get more balance and find better ways of developing KPIs. And you know, one option is this way, looking at different lenses, different dimensions. So KPIs around effectiveness of the process, KPIs around the control points, and KPIs around cash and value. And you know, that's an interesting way of trying to balance out the potential side effects of classical unintended consequences. But there's lots of interesting things we can measure, and that's one of the dangers also. KPIs are very interesting. The results of them can be interesting when they're measured, but there's a lot of things we can measure. We can measure inputs, we can measure outputs, we can measure the process itself, we can measure what the customer feels about it, we can measure what our people feel about it, but which of these help us achieve our core objectives? It's very easy to end up in a morass of potential indicators and losing sight of what's the outcome we really want here. So our indicators really should have a pretty clear focus. It should have some characteristics that allow us to be objective and compare them. Visibility, focus on what's important, objectivity, consistency. But they should also help us improve execution and decision-making, which means they've got to be action-based. They've got to give us a way of giving us clear feedback and identify what needs to change. And it should incent the right things, not the wrong things. So, you know, that's an interesting set of characteristics to mark your KPIs on. And this does bring us to the whole topic of leading and lagging indicators, because there's been much talk about this, and it's pretty obvious in any field of human endeavor. Leading indicators, early monitoring predicts trouble, helps us take evasive action, precautionary measures, whatever. Seismology is a pretty good predictive early indicator for identifying when unpleasant things are going to happen with earthquakes and volcanic activity, etc., and allows us to take sort of evasive action, as it were. So that's the same thinking with regard to our processes. And if you think about leading indicators and what they really are, I mean, it's nearly 21 years ago, Kaplan and Norton came out with their balanced scorecard thinking, which was, you know, a tremendous step forward in its area because they had identified all of these issues with KPIs. And they introduced two concepts. They introduced the concept of looking through multiple perspectives, typically looking at everything from a financial perspective, from a customer perspective, from a process perspective, and from a learning and growth or innovation perspective, the four dimensions in the balanced scorecard. But the other key thing they came up with was leading and lagging indicators. They identified that lagging indicators alone don't help. You need leading indicators. So you've got the cause and effect. So we know lagging indicators. It's pretty much, I would say, 90% of the KPIs you see are lagging indicators, which are measures of outputs, outcomes, and an accurate snapshot, which you can compare. But leading indicators are those things that you're in-process measures that impact the outcome. So they're more predictive. They can tell us whether things are going to work or not work or be effective or not effective. Now, it's easy to say that, but you know, balanced scorecards been around for, as I say, 21 years or whatever. A lot of companies have tried implementing it, but very few companies have actually been successful because it's complicated. And certainly the bit that's hardest is the leading indicator piece, because every leading indicator is a lagging indicator of something else further up the chain. So it's kind of chicken and egg. But it is important to recognize that the multiple perspectives is a big deal, and having leading and lagging indicators is important. We just need to find a better way of implementing that. So if you think about a balanced perspective on that way, trying to get some sense of lagging and leading, if you look at this as the end-to-end P2P cycle, lagging indicators are going to be based around efficiency, cost, and purchase savings, for example, the classic outcomes and measures of a purchase-to-pay process. But what are the leading indicators going to be? The leading indicators are going to be things like error rates, skills available, the data quality, the multiple revisions or otherwise of documents and transactions through the system, duplicates. These are all indicators of success, efficiency, and effectiveness, or indeed the opposite. So let's think about this and apply both our left brain and our right brain to it. I can never remember which is the more creative, the left brain or the right brain, but one of them. We need to apply both sides because most of us are very comfortable with the top two parts of this chart. Most of us have a pretty clear process taxonomy, a language to describe our processes. We can describe them internally, and we have a set of performance measures, KPIs. We've got those things, but we know we've got problems with them. What very few people are doing is looking at the unintended consequences of these performance measures. What can go wrong when we focus people towards these performance measures? What are the things that can impact and inhibit future performance, even if the indicator today is apparently green? So what we need to do is have a way of finding those things that get in the way of success, the exceptions in planned performance, and use these leading indicators to help diagnose root causes, gaps, and opportunities to improve our processes so we can take action, develop learning and good practice, and go round in a continuous improvement cycle. And I think that's one of the key things that's missing in classic KPI implementation. So look at a couple of examples here. So on the revenue cycle, and these are real examples at nameless companies for obvious reasons to save any embarrassment. So on the revenue side, DSO is a critical measure of cash flow. So they had some KPIs, which were we want all our receivables collected within 30 days, whatever the number was. And they were doing incredibly well. In fact, they were doing so well, it was almost unbelievable. And when we went in to look at this situation, it became pretty clear that something wasn't right. And what was actually happening in the process is because they were being targeted so tightly on this collections number, for their major customers with very large invoices, they produce an invoice, send it to the customer, and then they would talk to the customer to make sure that that was ready and correct and ready to go into the payment cycle. And only when the customer said, yes, it's going to go into the next payment cycle, they'd say, okay, don't use that document. I'm going to send you the proper invoice from our system now. And at that point, the KPI clock started ticking. So they had a ridiculously short collections cycle. But it was all because of the unintended consequences. They knew they had some data issues. The people in the process knew they had data issues. They had other issues. But they were told, you've got to hit this target. So their way of achieving it was actually not giving the result of getting cash in as early as they thought it was. There was a big gap between delivery of goods and services and the date of the real invoice that came out of the system. So what they started to look for there is invoices raised after delivery, a particular lag time. Beyond that, we've got an alert. We need to know what's going on. But there's other things as well that could affect that, like customer credit, non-standard payment terms, and if we've got problems in our delivery cycle. So let's think of another example on the purchase to pay cycle. So classic KPIs in P2P and accounts payable are spend under PO. We want to maximize the spend under purchase order so we can control it, and we want to maximize the effectiveness of three-way match. So you put those in place, and you can also put some system-based controls in to make sure that happens. And then what's the unintended consequences of that? Again, what we found here is that individuals involved, they knew they had to create a PO to go through the process, but in some cases, and for some reasons, they found it difficult to create the PO at the appropriate time. So when goods were delivered or invoices were received, they would realize, I've got to create a PO now, get that set up so they can then process the receipt or the invoice. Now, of course, the control system is perfectly happy because the purchase order was there at the point they entered the invoice receipt or the goods receipt. But the whole process wasn't working, and we were not getting control over the purchasing process. So therefore, the unintended consequences there led us to looking at exception indicators to do with POs created at the same time or same day as goods receipts and invoice receipts. The key point about all this is we've got to define what good looks like in sufficient detail so we can manage out defects in the process. And we've got to be able to work out what the wrong thing is as well. What are these unintended consequences? This will enable us to take effective management action to improve the process rather than just paper over the cracks, as though we can genuinely improve the whole cycle. So these exceptions are leading indicators. They're not the only leading indicators that exist, but they're very important ones. So we all know what should happen. We've got our process taxonomy, our picture of the business process, but we don't know enough about what actually does happen. When we have that clear visibility, that delta is what we need to take action on, do the root cause diagnosis, and improve. And that's this whole theme of key exception indicators. That's what we call those things. So if you think about leading indicators, there are two types, because as Kaplan and Norton said, leading indicators are important, and they do complement lagging KPIs. So nobody's saying that lagging KPIs are bad things. You just need to have lagging KPIs only focused on the critical outcomes and balanced with leading indicators. And there's two sorts of leading indicators. The broad enablers that we saw in balanced scorecard thinking, which was resourcing, skills, knowledge. Does the team have a process awareness? They understand about controls. Do we have common systems to integrate the whole thing? That's definitely a leading indicator, but much more core enabling. But the in-process diagnostics are the ones that tell us whether the process is actually working right and where these exceptions are happening, which are the unintended consequences of the way we set up our process and the way we're measuring people. So it's important to think about those and have that balance. So we've got another poll now, Susie, I think.
Yes, we do. So coming up on your screen now, we just want to find out how much you're using leading indicators in your own organization. So what kind of indicators is your organization using? Just lagging? Just leading? Some lagging, some leading? Complementary sets of leading and lagging? Or perhaps you are unsure? Closing the poll in 3, 2, 1. Bang on at 80%, so that's fantastic. Coming up on your screen now, you can see 50% of you saying some lagging and some leading, with 28% of you really just using lagging indicators. Back to you, please, Dan.
That's interesting, and 8% of people are using a complementary set of leading and lagging, so it'd be very interesting to run a webcast with their experiences as well. That's good to see. Okay, so there's some insight there. Let's talk about driving behavior with indicators. I hear a lot of talk, a lot of feedback in the companies I talk to, that people aren't paying enough attention to our KPIs. Management aren't paying enough attention, and the various issues associated with whether or not these things are important enough. So we have to ask the question, are we measuring the right things, and is it driving visible change? Got to ask the question, whose behavior is it we want to change? And a lot of this depends on where you are in this maturity cycle. But is it the direct team? Is it a cross-functional behavior we're trying to change? Is it senior shared services management? Is it the customer? So we've got to understand that. But in this maturity model, clearly, if the stakeholders aren't engaged, then that's number one issue to tackle. Got to get the stakeholders engaged in performance management, what it is we need to do to drive the behavior we want. Now, if you go through this, we know with the law of unintended consequences, the narrower the view we take on KPIs, the more likely we're going to get unintended consequences. So we want an end-to-end process view. want to look at the outcomes that shared services is producing as we go through this maturity model. Then we're thinking about the behaviours of shared services, and then the whole concept of service management from shared services out to the customer. And then the genuine relationship management with the customer, where it's sitting the same side of the table, and getting to the point where we can change the customer behaviours also, because this is an end-to-end process that everybody's involved in. And then if you get end-to-end process optimization, that you have a peak of maturity here. But you've got to make it important enough to the stakeholders and find the trigger. And I think if you get the situation that people can't find, they don't see the criticality in the measures, it's either because we have the wrong ones or they're not actionable enough, as we've been talking about. So talking about behavior, which is about action, we need to look at the process under the microscope, processes, the controls, performance measures. We've got to define what can go wrong, which is these unintended consequences. We've got to monitor process execution for exceptions from standard. We've got to diagnose those root causes. That's a collaborative exercise. And we've got to manage and fix those root causes. And then we've got to go through a continuous improvement process. Now, that is an action-oriented activity. It's not just measuring things. Now, the interesting piece about these KEIs is you'd expect exceptions, by definition, to be in the minority. So you might expect your exceptions to be anywhere from 1% to 10%, perhaps, of process execution. But they have an asymmetric impact on effort and efficiency, because fixing stuff after the fact takes a lot of time and pain. So by addressing these early and diagnosing root causes and fixing whole classes of these, we've got a much better way of performance improvement, which is non-disruptive. We can keep running the business and improve as we go. So if you think about a framework for action and behavior, you know, we've got our targets of what we want, what good looks like for us. What do we want our processes and organization to look like in terms of performance? We've got to be able to measure current process performance. And yes, we have tools like KPIs, the lagging indicators. We need those. But we also need those leading indicators that give us an insight into the process exceptions so we can see what's going wrong. Using those, we can then assess gaps and opportunities, which is this root cause diagnosis. Coming up with actions and initiatives to fix can be as simple as reinforcing policy or better training, or it might be a systematic change. But we need to engage that through the process community, which is where the whole process ownership piece comes in. Engage with that, implement those changes, and then we've got a continuous improvement framework. So that it is an action-oriented approach rather than just a measurement approach, which leads me to the topic of indicators and performance. Because it's not really enough to do performance measurement. Collecting and reporting information to assess and compare is definitely a good thing. There's no doubt about it, but it's not enough. We want performance management, which is using information to drive decisions and actions to improve, because we can always improve. Even when our dashboards are green, we can improve. So this is a much better thing, which again leads us to a thinking that it's not just about red, green, amber, how are we doing on our measures. It's more about what do we do to improve this and where are the critical areas. So this is the root of behavioral change, action. So Susie, we have another poll about managing performance.
Thank you, Dan. Coming up on your screen now. What is the biggest improvement you could implement in making indicators work for you? Improve the indicators, i.e. what we monitor. Improve data analytics, monitoring, reporting. Expose or manage actions for improvement. Get or enhance stakeholder commitment or other. So it's just one that you need to select here, because we're looking for the biggest improvement you could implement in making your indicators work harder for you. And coming up on your screen, 76% of you responded. So you can see here fairly evenly spread between the top three: improving the indicators, improving the data analytics, monitoring, reporting, exposing or managing actions for improvement. Interesting results. Back to you, please, Dan.
Very interesting that, yeah. Thank you for that. Let's talk about the customer, engaging the customer. So customer satisfaction is another heretical thought of mine, another KPI minefield. One of the classic key performance indicators in the shared services organization is customer satisfaction. And the challenge with this is we've all seen good sets of customer satisfaction surveys, but again, not sufficient engagement. Perhaps we're asking the wrong questions, perhaps we're asking the wrong people. But we've also got to ask ourselves, what is the relationship we have with our customer? Now, if we're an outsourced service center, there is a very clear customer relationship. But if you're a captive shared service center, we all have customers in our business lives. But really, we're all, certainly in a captive shared service center, we're all stakeholders and participants in an end-to-end process. So sometimes focusing on customer satisfaction as a key measure sometimes misses the point. Because whilst people may or may not be happy with the element you're performing, if you can optimize the whole process, you're going to get a lot better result and a better customer relationship. So let's revisit this journey, this maturity journey. And the term stakeholder here is replaced customer because we're very focused here on the customer engagement. Now, the critical thing here is we have to do whatever level we're at today. We have to be able to execute that well enough to be able to earn the right to go to the next stage. And ultimately, we want to engage deeply with the customer about shared actions to improve the overall end-to-end process because it is deeply integrated across the organization, across the business. It's not just in shared services. We only own a piece of it or two pieces of it in shared services. So it's kind of interesting to go through that and to try and get to the next level. And when thinking about the customer, sometimes it's difficult to establish, but the customer is a customer too. And how is your customer measured? And how your customer is measured by his customer kind of gives you some indication of how you need to focus what you deliver for them. I think the same maturity model is very valid. And I think getting to the point where you can sit down with a customer at the higher end of this maturity model and say, look, we're part of a common process here. What do we collectively do to make this work better? Because we can optimize the piece in shared services, but it's not going to make enough difference if we don't address the beginning and end of it as well. So it's definitely a key point in getting the customer engaged. And actions are always louder than words in this engagement. So rather than just the measures, once you get to the higher levels of this maturity model, you can actually expose your action-oriented thinking. In the early stages, they probably just want to see the measures. So let's think about communicating progress, both to the customer and to other stakeholders. And there's a lot of frustration with this one as well. We were asked to put in a dashboard of our KPIs, and we implemented it, and it was great. And then usage is dropping off, and nobody seems to care anymore. And I think with communicating progress and whatever reporting system you use, it comes back to the same question, which is central in a lot of these discussions, is we've got to think about the why before the what, and we've got to think about the what before the how. And the beautiful dashboard with traffic lights and pie charts and performance measures is great, but that's a how. We've got to make sure we understand why we're measuring, because it's important, what we're measuring, leading and lagging, and then how is an interesting follow-on factor, whether it's a zappy web-based dashboard or whether it's something else is secondary. But what I want to really get to is whatever the technology, whatever the flashy front end is, it's a thought process that really helps get this right. And it also helps with engagement of all stakeholders and with the customer. So this thinking is about analysis, insight, and decision. It's relevant to all indicators, leading and lagging, but most relevant to leading indicators because those are the ones that are more action-oriented. So analysis, insight, decision. It's about driving performance, and it's about looking at the results of our leading indicators, our key exceptions, doing an analysis to understand root causes. Why are these things happening? Getting to the insight of what is that root cause, and making a decision collectively, which isn't always straightforward, about what action are we going to implement to optimize this process. So you've got a basis for diagnosis. Improvements are constantly being identified and actioned and monitored and prioritized. And it is a thought process for engagement. I encourage everybody to think in this way, irrespective of how you report it. So you might want to think about this in terms of balancing those indicators, finding the performance gaps, using it to engage stakeholders, and driving action. And quite often, if you can focus on these improvement actions and a way of communicating the whole cycle, you'll get more engagement from your internal stakeholders. And as your maturity of relationship extends with your customer, you'll be able to expose it to them too. So process community is important. Focusing on critical indicators and make a difference. Communicate it and prove it. Sometimes you just need to take a process and prove it. So I'll just give you an example. And again, the way it's represented isn't really important. What's important is the thinking. So on the left-hand side of this picture, which has been sanitized to protect the innocent, there's some classic lagging KPIs, cost per invoice, discounts captured, etc. And there's the norm and there's a status against it, which is fine. But then that's where it deviates a little bit from the received wisdom. Then you've got the leading indicators, the key exceptions that are going to damage us in the future. And there's some targets there as well. But then we've got the insight. So what have we established about the root cause? And this is not going to be done overnight. Sometimes it takes some time, takes a collaborative endeavor to work out what these root causes are. Determine a root cause, agree on a set of actions, and identify an owner. Now, when you share this kind of, and again, it's not a whizzy dashboard, but when you share that form of thinking with your stakeholders and customers, it's much clearer about the fact that you're driving improvement and everyone's engaged in the process. So cost per invoice, for example, driving a cost per invoice down. Now, we know from experience, one of the side effects of that is because of automated to end-to-end process, you can end up with a slight spike in duplicates coming through. And so in this case, we found if duplicate payments are spiked, so what they need to do is implement some better way of monitoring the invoices so that before they get the payments and improve that process. And as you go down, you see similar examples. But the idea of analysis for both leading and lagging indicators, the insight about what do we learn from it, what are the root causes, and the decisions about what are we going to do, what are we going to implement, even if we're going to have to research what to do about it, it's clear that we're making progress. So on that note, I think we have another poll, Susie. I think it's the last poll.
We certainly do. So coming up on your screen now, poll number 6 for you, please. What would most significantly enhance your performance management regime today? Is it improved analysis of lagging indicators, improved analysis of leading indicators, better interpretation and insight on gaps or root causes, better focus and visibility on decisions to improve, or other? So a bit of a bell curve there, and 23% of you saying improved analysis of your leading indicators, and 42% of you coming in with better interpretation and insight on gaps and root causes. Okay, back to you, please, Dan.
That's very interesting as well. Just kind of pull this together with some recommendations. We've been through our known knowns. We've addressed some of the known unknowns, and we probably will never know the unknown unknowns. But let's look at this set of recommendations. So basically, we know as shared services, we've got to have a service culture. We've got to ensure we're as efficient as possible, which is cost competitive with alternative providers. And we've got to make sure we're effective as possible, which is this value-added approach and thinking about the customer's customer so we can address the whole end-to-end process. We've got metrics. We've got metrics we're tied to, but we've got those lagging KPIs, which we will report to the customer and to management. And the leading indicators, the key exception indicators, we want to use for process optimization, and we want to report those to stakeholders. And as our relationship strengthens with the customer, we want to actually report them to the customer as part of our stakeholders. They can see what we're doing collectively to improve the process. So it's got to be part of continuous improvement. It's got to be owned by the process community, clearly. And you've got to think about this analysis, insight, decision cycle to focus effort and ensure progress, because it's very clear when you've got analysis and no insight, or you've got insight and no decision, it's clear that you've got to do something. It's clear there's a logjam. Just a measure of performance isn't enough. So we said at the beginning of this, the key question is, what's so key about your KPIs? And are your performance measures fit for purpose? I think there's three key takeaways. Hopefully we've given you some food for thought. I think the three key things here is you've got to review your indicators on the end-to-end process or end-to-end service. You've got to reduce the lagging KPIs to key outcomes, and you've got to address that associated leading indicator, key exception indicator idea. And the best way of doing that is getting stakeholders around a table in some form of workshop to at least share this thinking and get them to work out what can go wrong in the law of unanticipated consequences. The analysis, insight, decision cycle, definitely use that to analyze your leading indicators, and you may need to do some kind of point-in-time assessment on a process, which might be the catalyst to get more focus on it. And then the behavior and the customer, I think it's all about action. If you can demonstrate your performance measurement and performance reporting is about action, not just about reporting to say how well we've done, then I think we get a lot more engagement. So we've got to focus on those indicators that support the right behavior, ensure that we have got the right customer engagement model for our level of maturity, and we'll consider reporting that analysis, insight, decision progress with the customer themselves. So as a final thought, we can complain about our KPIs, we can hope it all comes out in the wash, or we can take some action. And that's paraphrasing an interesting quote I saw with that great ocean-going racer there. So thank you for that. I think we are now going to go into questions. If you are interested in the white paper that backs this up, which is Performance Improvement from Measurement to Action, getting into more detail about what we've talked about, by all means, send me an email and I'll get someone to send it to you. But on that, I will hand you back to Susie, who has the questions.
Thank you very much, Dan. How about dynamic KPIs, Dan? I suppose the question is more around the frequency of KPIs. Do you encourage people changing their KPIs, you know, every quarter, every month, every 6 months? What's your view on the frequency of change?
I don't think there's a fixed time scale for a KPI's lifespan. But I do think once measurement no longer becomes relevant, either because you've achieved your best-in-class level, it may be it becomes less important, and it may be you can change it. That's perfectly reasonable. But I don't think you say, okay, after 3 months, we're going to change it. Because I think just chopping and changing, when you're trying to drive change and improvement, these things are not trivial and don't happen overnight. So I think arbitrarily changing on a fixed time period is dangerous.
Mm-hmm. What's your view on an optimum number of KPIs to be issuing out to your team and individual members?
This is a thorny one. I think it depends on what level you're operating. So at a process, end-to-end process level, I would say no more than 5. And for each of those, you should have a corresponding leading indicators. Now, if you're taking it down to an individual team, then you might want to have a couple. But you don't want to give people too many different things to worry about. But you've got to have the comparable leading indicators that go with the lagging measures.
Mm-hmm. What are the most common key exception indicators in the leading sense that you encounter for shared services and purchase to pay?
There's a lot of data quality related stuff. So master data leading indicators affects a lot of things. So when you've got poor master data, incomplete master data for vendors or customers, that is one of those things that causes lots of downstream issues. Duplicates, errors, the things that should be single touch or automated that get multiple touches. So invoices, for example, or even purchase orders that go through multiple revisions. So those are 4 or 5 classic ones.
Mm-hmm. I know that you referred to them in the first part of your presentation, but maybe you could just draw on them one more time in terms of what most companies are tracking with their KPIs and record to report.
The record to report, well, as I say, the key outcome for record to report is usually the period to close, so whether you're going for 4 working days or whatever. And then there's a whole bunch of indicators which are to do with efficiency ones, which is how many people you need to process the journal entries and all that stuff. But I think the exception ones are often to do with manual journal entries and repeated journal entries into certain types of accounts. I can actually probably provide afterwards to whoever's asking that some more specific details. Off the top of my head, that's what I have.
Mm-hmm. Okay, great. There's a question here about addressing softer issues. So I suppose it's more about attitude and the kind of culture that you've got in your organisation and making sure that the culture in your organisation is as optimum or high-producing as it can be, if you will, and positive and problem-solving. What suggestion have you got to address the soft issues with KPIs?
Well, I think one of the key ways of starting that discussion is actually by getting into this very discussion about unanticipated consequences and about making sure that everybody realizes, look, there's no single measure that's going to tell us we're doing great or not great. It's a balance. And having that conversation in a mature way with all parties, all stakeholders in the process, all participants in the process, it doesn't become judgmental about how well a different, particular group is doing or not doing. I think that discussion is very enlightening and it improves, you can't do it in one meeting, but that discussion definitely helps. And then the other piece is that it's not just about a scorecard. It's not about trying to get loads of greens. It's about what do we do to improve the process. And I think if you can get people to buy into the fact, and quite often it's actually not the people in the process, quite often it can be the top management sometimes. Our goal here isn't just to say how well we're doing. Our goal is to work out how do we keep improving. Because if we're not improving, we're going backwards. And I think that is a key part of the culture, to be an action-oriented culture rather than just a measuring culture. And one of the ways of starting that is these kind of roundtable discussions around what do we measure and how do we balance lagging with leading and get everybody's input on it.
What is a typical governance body that you recommend is presented with the insights and asked to make decisions on improvement?
That's interesting. It does change depending where you are in the maturity model. So let's say, for the sake of argument, that in the current performance, if the customer doesn't really care yet about how you do what you do, then that has to be the process community within shared services. And sometimes you're going to need the systems people when it's to do with ERPs. If you've got a good relationship with the customer, then you want that to be a roundtable with the overall process owner for the company and participants from regions or business units and people involved in executing the process. And you just put a process community together like you would for other process improvement initiatives.
How can you present a compelling enough business case to your shared services customers to convince them that the current KPIs used in their SLAs should be reassessed?
I'm not sure it's a business case because reassessing, I think if the simple question is, if the organization is happy with the performance measures they have and it's achieving the result they want, have at it. That's great. Don't change anything. But most organizations, you already know if there's a problem. And if people say, you get some questions like, the performance indicators say one thing, but the feedback I get from the customer is different. You get lots of indicators in conversation about why things aren't working. Now, a business case for addressing them, well, remember, to start with, is about having the conversation, first of all, internally, and if you have a good relationship with the customer as well. And then is the question, what are we going to do about it? And it's not about presenting a business case. It's about saying, is there something we need to do, or are we happy with what we've got?
I'm afraid we are now out of time, everyone. So many thanks to you for joining, and many thanks to Dan French. And if you would like to get in contact with him, we will be sharing his email address. So we look forward to welcoming you next time. Thank you and goodbye.